Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this session where we will be diving into an interesting and ever-relevant topic of building agile and resilient brands. In a world where change is the only constant, the ability of brand to adapt to market dynamics, changing consumer preferences, while being resilient has become more important than ever. And we are fortunate enough to have Pecky sharing with us, sharing her insights and experiences with us. Having worked with many iconic brands, and some of which are known for their agility and resilience, this conversation is going to be very interesting, and I'm so looking forward to have a chat with you. But something which is more interesting than this is that Pecky is not only successfully navigating the current of marketing and brand management, but she's also exploring the depths of the ocean. And Pecky, as an amateur scuba diver, I am very curious, and I want to ask you this question: that what inspired you to take up scuba diving?
I think the adventure of being a teenage son's mother is what I think took me there, because it's a roller coaster ride for me, because I'm trying to really balance my need to stay connected with my son, while in some sense really appreciate and acknowledge his need to appear indifferent, you know, empowered and independent. So when he took to scuba, I thought, and he thought it was an adventure sport, I thought I should follow him. The interesting thing, however, I think is, while it's called an adventure sport, for me it's become so therapeutic, because at the end of the day, I don't know how many people in this room has indulged in that sport. It's actually yoga, because all you really do is go deep under and keep breathing, focusing on your breathing, listening to yourself breathe while you marvel nature. So I think long answer to a short question, which is something you'll face, I will avoid. But yeah, it's my son, I think, who got me there.
Wonderful, and I would agree with you, because it's very therapeutic and I find a lot of peace deep inside the water. From Coke in 2003 to your roles at the Tata Consumer Products and IHCL, and now as the CMO of Tanishq, how do you view your career through the lens of agility and resilience?
I think throughout, I've had the luxury of, you know, having worked with organization, been on certain brands in those organizations who have seen to be resilient and who have proven, I think, you know, with track records to not only, I think, like they announced, not only kind of survived through difficult times, but really thrive and, you know, tap into potential. I want to talk more, I think, about the resilience bit, because I'm of the view that as far as agility goes, it's what resilient brands do, it's how they act. So it's not that a brand is resilient and agile, I think it's because of their agility they also become resilient. If I had to kind of connect the dots through my learnings, through my experience, if there is one thing, I think, from a standpoint of resilience, which I see common, is actually something very simple. It goes back to basic fundamentals of marketing. It's the first principle of marketing, which is understand your customer and stay true to the purpose or the core of the brand. Because when you truly understand what your brand is or what it is not, it has the potential not only to impact communication or impact the way we engage with customers, but I feel it truly kind of also helps shape business strategy, portfolio strategies, and at times culture and identity of organizations. Very early on, I think, in my career at Coke, this was a big learning when I think Limca at that time was, you know, going through almost 16 quarters of degrowth. And the only time we actually managed to pivot is when we went back to the fundamentals. And this was around a time when Limca, for instance, was facing the degrowth, not only because of competition outside, but even also within the organization, because there were a lot of international brands which were coming in, you know, whether it's Coke, Sprite, Pepsi with its Thunder. And through it all, I think what at Limca we were trying to do was to see how can we make the brand cooler, just so that we kind of fit within the category codes of carbonated beverage. I think the only time we actually managed to fix that was when we stopped doing aesthetic changes, went back to basics to say, who really drinks me and why do they drink me? And that's when we realized that at the end of the day, Limca was a cool Indian soft drink brand. It had a very strong equity because at the end of the day, it was Nimbu Pani with carbonation and hence the ideal beverage to beat the Indian summer. And if we were trying to do anything different with that brand, we would not be able to kind of match up to the glitz and glamour that international brands were coming in with. What it helped us do, like I mentioned, is not just hence fix the communication, but also understand as a brand what is the role that it plays within the Coca-Cola portfolio to really say that maybe then, with an older target audience, it is a brand that extends the lifespan, the drinking lifespan of an individual or the cohort. And more importantly, as an outcome of that, what started happening is investments came back on Limca. You know, planning around Limca became simpler. So I truly believe that going back to basics, understanding customer and really getting the sense of what the brand's purpose is all it takes to be a resilient brand. If you don't know it already, it's that relentless pursuit, I think, you know, which needs to continue. Other examples, I think, was say, for instance, that when I was at the Taj Hotel, once I joined the Tata Group, I think the Taj Hotel has this basic commitment and promise of Tajness since we are in one today. I hope all of you are experiencing it. And Tajness is basically a promise of sincere care, you know, which is based on true Indian hospitality. It's about that sincere care that you talk about. And I was with the Taj Group for about a year and a half during the most difficult times where, you know, when the top lines were zero during COVID. So imagine running a business when the top lines are zero. And I think it is this core proposition of Tajness, which was not just for the consumer, but what each individual within the company felt. In some sense, it gave all of us an identity. It gave all of us a culture of thinking about how do you still continue to care with sincerity, and which is why, I guess, when the Taj Group of hotels opened the doors for healthcare workers or, for that matter, for people who wanted to quarantine or went on to say that if you cannot come to the Taj, let me build an app in 2-3 months called Cumin and bring Taj home to you. All of this, I think, went back to the, you know, why, which is understanding what the brand core is. And that's what I think really makes brands resilient. And as an outcome of that, with that simplicity, what happens, I guess, is it kind of liberates you to kind of quickly pivot, adapt, evolve as and when circumstances change.
Wow, that's wonderful. I think that's a wonderful insight, that going back to the basics and staying true to the brand's core value. But what a wonderful journey, Pecky. And you have ensured that each of the brands has remained relevant and resilient. So my next question to you is, it's a rather a long question. In your experience spanning over 2 decades, have you found that the need for agility and resilience has remained the same, or it has become more than before? And if it has increased, what do you see as the primary driving force? Is it consumer behavior, competition, technological advancement, or organizational dynamics?
I think the second half of the question is the easy one, because I answered it with my first question, because I'm a true believer that everything starts with consumer. Everything that happens, which we sometimes worry about, get excited about, whether it's media landscapes changing or digitization coming in, it's all impacting the consumer at the end of the day. So at the heart of it, it's always that. But to answer the first half of your question, definitely, I think, building resilient brands is the order of the day, and one needs to do it with a lot of agility. The pace has changed, I guess, because like you said, right, when you were talking about change being the only constant, the pace of change has accelerated on one side. And on the other side, I guess the whole definition of change also has changed, if I may. Oh my God, too many changes in this answer. So if we were to kind of, you know, go back to jargons that we talk about, you know, when we talk about change, there's the DVCARD world and all of that, right? If you just look at it, like something as simple as, you know, what does volatility mean 10 years back and what it means today? Just the scope and definition would have changed. Or for that matter, when we talked about ambiguity 10, 15 years back, it meant maybe I didn't have access to information about my customer. I didn't have access to information in the market. But today, the whole scope of, you know, just that piece has also changed, because today what is happening is you have excess information, and a lot of the confusion comes because you don't know whether it's truly an insight or is it, you know, noise. Or it could be that with the pace of change that we're doing, a lot of our understanding, we also base it on, I guess, you know, trends, etc. Now, we don't know if historical trends are still relevant today. And just this morning, I think I was talking with my team, and you know, today I work with Tanishq, in case, you know, I haven't brought Tanishq up. And the way the jewelry business works is that we have a calendar year which is very heavily pegged on festivals, and because, you know, it's a very culturally, you know, tradition, rituals really impact how the consumer's jewelry buying behavior is. And I mean, 5-10 years back, if we said that there were certain times in the year when the sales are really low because it's inauspicious to buy, it's the Shraddh phase. Today, what we are increasingly noticing is that that's no longer relevant, because there are certain sets of consumers who are buying jewelry for daily wear, where, you know, there are other factors that come into play. There are other motivators and other triggers. Say, for instance, then I'm just looking for what can I wear for a change? Do I have something which is more versatile? Do I have a repertoire of pieces to choose from? And hence, if I have to buy it during a Shraddh, so be it. You know, so I think it's just interesting how both the pace and the design of change has gone about, which is why I think within our organization, one of the things we talk about is, yes, agility is important, but it's mindful agility which becomes critical, because whenever we are looking at everything that's guiding our action, we need to be mindful about what is it that we're picking up.
Great. And I'm going to pick Tanishq up now. Building an agile and resilient brand starts with an organization culture. So as the CMO of Tanishq, how do you ensure that the brand remains resilient and agile, and how do you communicate the need to change or adapt to the changes to your last mile and your channel partners?
First and foremost, I think it's my privilege and honor that I've kind of inherited a legacy brand like Tanishq, because I'm relatively new to the brand. And I think for the last 20 odd years, or rather last three decades, what has really happened is, as far as Tanishq goes, we've just gone back to basics again. So if we were to kind of very simplistically look at, you know, at Tanishq, when do we think that we've done a good job? And hence, what's the purpose? Very simplistically put, if a modern Indian woman feels that Tanishq is a brand that's on her side, it's a job well done. and that's all we need to do, right? So over the years, you know, I think one of the most visible aspects of Tanishq is our communication. And because of a very simple purpose like this, even the way we look at communication has been kept very simple, where we really say that, you know, we know that every modern Indian woman can really, you know, carve out or create, has new perspectives and can carve out a narrative of her own. And as long as we stay true to kind of showing this, celebrating that about the modern Indian woman, at times maybe amplifying if a modern Indian woman wants her voice heard, or at times just being her voice from a communication standpoint, I think we end up doing it. So going to the question you asked, how do we make sure that, you know, we kind of do this, it goes back again to having a very, I think, strong brand that has been defined over the years. However, with, you know, with the changing, you know, in some sense, I guess, what digitization has done is fueled our agility to understand what's happening with our customers, with what's happening with our potential customers also. And hence, our read of them, our understanding of them is what it has enhanced. So we've embraced digitization, technology of any sort that gives us better understanding of trends, better understanding of our customers, which has helped us. I have some team members here who are also constantly working on, hence, what's the next best action that we can, you know, tempt our customers with. So there's a lot of that which is going behind the scene. And with that, I think what we've managed to do over the years is also to kind of tap opportunities at a community level, purely because, you know, with the way India is growing, even tier one, tier two cities are growing, each community has so much potential to give. So while understanding the core of the brand gives us the foundation, it liberates us to have fun. So one of the things that we do continuously basis a lot of the consumer work that we end up doing is, for instance, I think, how is Tanishq seen in Tamil Nadu, right? So I don't know if any of you have seen our campaign, which we call the Pundumai Pen, which is really a very nuanced, you know, brand campaign, which is anchored in largely, you know, the women of Tamil Nadu, who has this beautiful dual role that they play, which is, you know, as a custodian of the heritage and culture on one side, and on the other side, the change maker. And then if you just kind of run across from Tamil Nadu to West Bengal, the same Tanishq brand is nuanced to kind of really celebrate the Bengali woman. And there, the role of the Bengali woman as an embodiment of Ma Durga is one, you know, who has a lot of strength, who has a lot of courage, in some sense, to not only stand for what is right, but also take care or take responsibility for future generations. So the same brand, just on the basis of a core promise, just on the basis of deep understanding of regions, you know, we're able to really nuance it. And that's something as a team, you know, we always continuously do. We've obviously also kind of ensured that we are present where, you know, our customers, guests, etc., want to see us. So as a team, we are constantly experimenting. It's a part of not just Tanishq, but a part of the Titan culture. It's one of the core values. And as a team, one of the things we always try and do is to say, you know, have we experimented enough? And have we failed enough in some sense? Because unless and until you failed in a few, you've not really experimented. And we do that on a continuous basis. And we do that, and you know, as organizations become larger, I think you were kind of talking about, you know, partners, etc. What also happens is that, you know, you need to build functional expertise in some sense. So there's, in some sense, a risk of, you know, people working in silos. So the other thing that, you know, at Tanishq we definitely kind of look at doing is that while we excel and perform in what we are meant to deliver, we kind of come together as cross-functional teams to look at and find some space during our day, during the multiple job list that we have to do to also look at long-term agenda so that we have a common understanding of where the brand is headed from where we are now. So I think a lot of these things, which is very culture dependent, which is very organizational structure dependent, which is tapping into, you know, some of the things which are changing in the external landscape, like digitization, media, but all of that going back to what is core to the brand and, you know, our understanding of the customer is, I think, what takes us to work on a resilient brand which can deliver with agility.
And Peggy, did you see a big smile on my face when you mentioned Pudhumaipen? Because I think for 2 years we partnered with Tanishq, the Hindu group partnered with Tanishq, and we executed the lovely property and so many memories. I mean, all of us sitting here, all of us have so many memories to share. Okay, so next question.
I think with Hindu, we were really able to amplify the celebration because we were, I think, calling in also.
Oh, that's wow, the team.
That's the first
that's the team, yeah.
First applause. Now yeah. I know what I need to do to get applause.
Yes.
So, yeah, I think because we did also, you know, extend the campaign into inviting people to nominate, you know, the customers to kind of nominate their Pudhumaipens. And so it was a beautiful, I think, 360 campaign which finally got executed.
Wonderful. So building an agile and resilient brand is important, but it comes with many challenges. And in a category as traditional as jewelry, and that too in a market like India, what are the unique challenges Tanishq faces in this journey?
I don't think that the challenges come on account of us operating in a category which is traditional, because at the end of the day, that's the beauty of it, that, you know, you're rooted in tradition, rooted in culture, and yet trying to build brands, create products, you know, which have a modern aesthetic. I think the complexity comes from scale in some sense, especially for an organization like ours. Today we are like almost 500 stores strong in more than 270 cities across. So at times what happens is certain kind of execution, no matter how quick the decision making would have been or how quickly we picked up on a trend, takes its time. You know, for instance, today we know that when it comes to consumer, there even the jewelry browsing behavior is changing, and I'm not talking digital because that's an easier fix, but I'm talking in the offline stores. You would have seen that some of our newer mall stores, etc., the way we've done the planogramming, the way you know, all our displays are done is keeping in mind of what the modern day consumer is, which is they like to walk around, they like to look, they like to pick up things, you know, play with it a bit. But now, but to get this executed across 400, 500 stores in the country takes its time. So I think that's one, which is more an easy, is a simple problem to have, but a difficult one to execute. Besides that, I think, like I spoke of a little while back, with scale, we look for efficiencies, we look for excellence in each function, so there's always a risk of people working in silos. The fact that we today have cross-functional teams where we intentionally go after the midterm, long-term agendas, and we have common KPIs, common goals that we are chasing. Those are, I think, you know, one of the challenges. But I guess it's not all doomsday, because what also happens when you're in a large-scale organization, I spoke of mindful agility, is to that extent, I think you're covered. Because, you know, when you're trying to move with agility, besides your brand core being defined, which kind of liberates you to have fun with the brand, what large organizations also do have some systems, processes, policies, etc., which act as guardrails to kind of, you know, keep you on track in some sense. So, yeah, I guess that's where it comes from.
As a consumer, I love the brand Tanishq, and as a marketeer, I admire it even more. Tanishq has constantly been innovative and introducing campaigns that are ahead of times that challenge societal norms. How do you balance this innovation while maintaining the brand's core value?
For Tanishq, I think because we've kept the brand core value simple, you know, and it's also a core value that we constantly go back to. So it's not like this core value has not been revisited in the last 20, 25 years, 30 years that we've been speaking of. What we do is we keep visiting the core value to see, you know, is it still relevant today? And over a period of time, what we've realized is women being celebrated for their perspective, for women narratives being showcased to the world is here to stay. Bringing in fresh perspective is here to stay. And, you know, it's a long-term cultural trend, if I may call it that. What does change, I think, is the context in which she operates. So maybe 20 years back, we were talking about narratives that included her relationship with her husband, her family, her friends, and hence, you know, beautiful campaigns like Tales of Tradition, I think, which was done 20 years back, or The Second Marriage, which happened in 2013, one of my favorite campaigns when, you know, I was also not at Tanishq. To today, you know, when the woman is multifaceted, and in some sense, the context in which she brings in, she's a change maker, the context in which she brings in the fresh perspective has changed, which is why today we do, for example, stories which we did recently, like we did on Father's Day, or we did on Women's Day, where we really called out saying that today when you talk about a woman being a superwoman, because she's a mother, she's a daughter-in-law, she's a housewife, she's a wife, she's herself, and then she's of course a working woman, and we really say that, wow, you're a superwoman, is that really a compliment or an expectation? So as a brand, the core of saying that I understand the woman, the modern Indian woman, I'm on her side, holds, but the context in which we say has been changing. And we make sure that every now and then we are continuously going back. I think it's a very at an organizational cultural level, you know, what we end up doing is really meeting consumers quite regularly, being in the market. The advantage is we have our own stores, so we get to interact. More than 55% of our customers are repeat customers. Some of them have been with the brand for 20, 24 years. They feel they are more brand custodians than any of us youngsters who have been with the brand for the last 2-3 years. So that really keeps us on our toes, that keeps us relevant, and I think, yeah, that's where it is. Time's up.
Earlier, I just said that, you know, as a consumer, I love the brand, and as a marketeer, I admire the brand. And as a person from the newspaper industry, I cherish the romance you have with print. Now, given the rapid shift to the digital platform, how does print fit into your brand strategy? And I was compelled to ask this question. So.
Now I'm not going to get an applause from this side of the room for sure. Yeah, so I think with print, it's the jewelry category, right, which has been evolving in some sense. And from what we understand, in fact, I think I was reading an article that the World Gold Council kind of published 2-3 days back, where they were saying that today in India, when people buy jewelry, almost 45% is for adornment, 55% continues to remain investments. This number was, I'm told, a 30-70 till a few years back. And hence, you know, print as a response medium, print as a medium through which you educate customers when it comes to anything where the entire, your buying unit is the family. So while the choice on design, the choice on, you know, does it look good on me, stays largely with the woman, the final decision to buy is a joint decision. So print, I think, will remain an integral part of it. Also, print allows us in some sense to kind of do targeted communication across, purely because of, kind of show big impact overnight, because the reader, if nothing else, the people reading that print paper would have seen the advertisement. And given that jewelry is a very, very community-based product, this whole, you know, kind of media being segmented is easier. I think the good news with all print mediums is, you know, how actively you've also embraced the digital world. So in a lot of conversations that we end up having with you and all the your other partners, I think we see the association continuing. Yeah.
Oh, that's so good to hear, and I am sure that the team sitting there is very, very happy. It looks like that we are running, out of time. But before we open the floor to audience question, I have this last question of my own. Do you think that CMOs, and especially women CMOs, make good CEOs?
I think, I'm taking it back to Tanishq, the brand, because we clearly believe that women, by pure virtue of just being who they are, bring in a perspective which is very different, which is empathetic. And as long as we're not measured by the guardrails of what makes a successful CMO or a successful CEO from a standpoint of personality type or archetype, forget CMO, CEO, women could rock in any profession. Why not the board and why not the MDs?
Wow, so I have a very bright future. And all the marketeers sitting there. So I think we can take up a few audience questions. Can we open the floor? Yeah? Okay. No problem. Sorry, I think,
I take a long time to explain things, so I'm sorry if I've just kind of extended things, but it was lovely. Thank you for taking out time to listen to us.
Yeah, and I think it was a very, very interesting chat. And thank you so much for being a lovely audience. And thank you so much, Pecky, for sharing your journey with us. And we wish you the best. And we see that, you know, Tanishq, we are looking forward to see that Tanishq continue to thrive under your leadership. So all the very best. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.